This video is for Dr. Eads' students. This is from her study guide, exam 4. And I'm going to be doing problems from that study guide for students in her class. Okay. So before we begin talking about it, let's talk about some basic equations. This is Gibbs free energy. It's basically product minus the Gibbs free energy of reactants. Patricia went over with these. Gibbs free energy is equal to delta H minus T delta S. Delta H is enthalpy. T is temperature in Kelvin. Delta S is entropy. Delta H products minus delta H reactants. Delta S is equal to delta S products minus delta S reactants. In the test, she will give you the individual delta H's or delta S's associated with the compounds that she has. Also, based on what I see in the Scantron test, the equations you get will be balanced, so you do not have to worry about balancing the equations. These are all consistent with what you learned in Chem 1 with the thermochemical equations. On them, you're only worried about this. Difference here is you're worrying about this, 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 and this. And this is all definition. So the best way to do these is rather than trying to go theoretical, I'm just going to start doing problems. Everybody got this? Okay, so the first problem I'm going to do
is problem 4 from our study guide.
They give us all the delta G values. The question is, calculate the standard free energies of formation, which is delta G. Again, I'm going to write it out. Delta G is equal to delta G reactants minus delta G products. Okay? I'm sorry, my mistake. Products minus delta G reactants. Okay? Okay. How do you calculate this? You do. As you go into the table, I'm going to do the first one, but I need help with everybody's information. When you go into the table, I'm going to write this down for the, is you look at what's the delta G of NO. It's plus 86.69 kilojoules per mole. So what I want to do is calculate the delta G products right here. It's the way I do it separately. So the first one is NO, so I put that in, which is 86.69 kilojoules per mole, and that's NO, plus the delta G of SO2, and based on this chart, it's minus 300 kilojoules per mole. And here's something that's important. You notice all the information is per mole. So if this equation had two of these, or two of these, you would be multiplying this number by 2. Okay, so that's why the word kilojoules per mole. Okay, so if we do this, I just need somebody in the calculator, is to give me what's the delta G of product. Negative 2, 13.31?
Yeah.
Okay, did someone else get that?
Yes.
Okay. In future ones, I won't put down the units. I'll just assume that we know. Okay, now delta G of reactants. It's going to be, again, we look at NO2, and that's 51.84 kilojoules per mole plus SO2, which is minus 370?
Yep. So I'll get rid of that and put that in minus 370 kilojoules per mole. And I'm looking for an answer for that. Negative 318.16. Okay. My mistake, this is what you're going to run into also. This is SO3, right?
That SO3 over here?
Yeah. So I screwed that up, so this should be SO3. That's good, so everybody can see real time. And SO3 is minus 370. And SO2 is minus 300. So my mistake, and I'm glad I'm doing this because this will happen on the test. You notice the difference is a 2 and a 3? So I didn't do this intentionally. You've got to be very careful. Let's try it again, okay? Sorry. What do we get when we do this? 283.31, and how about this one?
Negative 248.16.
Thank you. Okay, now we go back to our equation, delta G. We got delta G product, which is minus 283.31 minus 248.16. And let's do that and see what we get.
Negative 34.15.
Okay, negative 34 or 35?
35.
Which is the correct answer. And again, we're doing problem 4, and the correct answer is this. I'm glad I messed up because this is what's going to happen on the test, potentially. Most of these have an NO2 or NO3 or SO2, SO3. And if you are a little bit dyslexic when you do this, you saw how I put the wrong number in. And I'm pretty sure if we did the math, we'd be getting one of these other answers. So the key to doing this for me is I don't try to do it all in one shot. I try to get the products separate, try to get the reactants separate, then I put them together. For you, you can do whatever works for you. I recommend this way because as the problems get more complicated, it gets more difficult to sort out. And if you miss one minus sign or one plus sign, you'll get the wrong answer. And unfortunately, that wrong answer may be on the Scantron. Everybody, does this make sense? Again, I'm sure that's how she did it. Okay, can I erase this? Okay, so. Okay, the next one I'm going to do is problem 5. Again, from her study guide. Problem 5, they want to find the standard entropy change. So we got HgH2 gas plus I2 solid. Again, on the test, almost all the instructors do not give you a table. They just give you the actual value, so you don't have to worry about looking this up on a table. This is a big table in the book. You don't have to worry about looking that up. Most likely, they'll just give it to you. Okay, same thought process. You want to find delta S here. So delta S is equal to delta S products minus delta S reactants. Okay? Again, you can do whatever works for you, but I like to do it this way so I make fewer errors. And you saw how I did that first one with even fewer errors. So delta S products is going to be equal to 2, because that's the number of moles in the equation, times the entropy value of HI, which is plus
206, okay, joules per mole per degree Kelvin. Okay, piece of information. Typically, entropy numbers are much smaller than enthalpy numbers. Enthalpy is delta H. So when you combine them, you'll see. If you look at these are all joules. The one we just did was kilojoules. Well, during the test, you're going to have situations where they may give you the answer in joules or kilojoules, okay? So let's look at this one, okay? Okay, so I need someone to do this number for me. Well, and I'm not going to put any more numbers in here. And of this reactants is going to be 130, 16 plus 116.12. What do we get when we get that?
246.72.
Thank you. Same drill. Well, does everybody see why I put a 2 here?
That's from the 2 moles of the HI.
Right, so that's, again, that I'm looking for, okay, so now we do delta S is equal to 412, and again, I'm going to be a little sloppy here, minus 246.72. What do we get when we do that?
165.8.
Okay, and she rounded it to 0.3. Okay, let's look at problem 5. Do you notice something weird there? The answer is in kilojoules, and our answer is going to be in joules, right? Do you see that? This answer is going to be in joules because all information is in joules, right? Everyone see that? Okay. We know also 1 kilojoule is 1,000 joules. Okay. So what's the difference here? The difference is that's a mistake. The answer should be 163 joules. Because there's no way if you put this in here, you would divide this by 1,000, that number would become real small. So that's a mistake. That I believe Dr. Eads has corrected on some of these versions, but in this case, this is a mistake. All right, and the reason is, there's no way we can get kilojoules that are going to be that number. This is really the answer. So on your study guide for 5, indicate that answer is going to be in joules. So does everybody follow what I'm doing? Any questions? Okay, now let's make this more complicated, because these are pretty easy. Okay,
let's do problem 1 now. Again, from our study guide.
Can I erase this? Everybody good? Okay. Question is, calculate the standard free energy change, delta G. But they don't give you delta G information. They just give you delta H and S information. What that means is you've got to go back and look at this equation, because we have 2 equations. Delta G is equal to delta G products minus delta G reactants. Okay, in this problem, they give you this information and this information. What we're going to do with that is calculate the delta G's for the respective compounds. Once we get them, this is the way I like to do it, we'll put it in this equation. You try to do it all in one big equation and put it in your calculator, odds are pretty good that you'll make a mistake. You don't have to do it. It's up to you, okay? So, And remember, in this equation, this is in degrees Kelvin. So, did she get into what is the standard temperature for these? 25 degrees or zero?
25.
Okay. So if you notice here, they don't say anything. They keyword standard free energy. If they say standard free energy and they don't give you a temperature, you use 25 degrees when it has to be converted to Kelvin. Again, just to refresh everybody, temperature degree Kelvin is 273 plus temperature degree centigrade. So that's going to be 273 plus 25. You and I can do that in my 298. Okay, so that's going to be the number. We're going to do this when we finally get this together. But right now, again, the way I like to do it is to go take this problem piece by piece. Okay, so the first part of this is I want to calculate okay, what I want to do is calculate the respective delta G's for each compound. Okay, so let's go back to the equation. The equation is CO. And again, I don't think she'll do this, but she might. For thermodynamics, it's important to know what the state of the compound is because you'll get a different value of delta S and delta G depending whether it's a liquid, gas, or solid. Okay, I don't think they do something difficult, but just keep that in the back of your head. So what we want to do now is just calculate the individual delta G's without doing any manipulation. So delta G for nickel, CO4. Okay, first of all, we look at coefficient, 1, so we don't have to do anything fancy here. So now we plug in this equation, which is going to be delta H minus T delta S, which is going to be, what's the delta H value for it? It's going to be minus 220 kilojoules per mole. I'm not going to put that in there. Minus the temperature, which is 298. Now, here's a place where almost everybody makes a mistake. What's the S value in here? It's in joules. So we got to convert it to kilojoules. So to convert it to kilojoules, we would take 298 times, we would divide this number by 1,000. Does everybody see that? Okay, when we divide it by 1,000, I get 0.399. I don't trust my math skills.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just want to make sure. Okay. So I'd like everybody to do the math here and give me a kilojoule value for this one. As you can see, this test is not going to be hard from a, in chapter 18, hard from a standpoint of understanding the concepts, but laborious. And may take a while to get the answers. Okay, you guys don't have calculators, right? You don't have yours either?
I have my phone.
Yeah, it's up to you. I just want to.
I got -338.
What did you get? -3?
38.902.
Okay. Close enough. Okay, that makes sense.
Is that 0.39 coming from 399 right there?
Yep.
Okay.
It's 300, 120. Yeah, looks, that feels good. Okay. Okay, same thing here. Delta G for the next one is going to be Ni. It's going to be equal to, again,
I'm not gonna do this, since we already went through this, so we go and look up the delta H value. And the delta H value for nickel is nothing.
Zero.
Yeah, right. Okay, you're asking why. For an element, the delta H value is always going to be zero. What's an element? Anything in the periodic table. It's by itself. Compound is anything in the is anything that has two or more elements together in the periodic from the periodic table. And that's going to be minus T, which is 298, times delta S, and delta S is going to be 0.196. See, nickel is no minus. It's at plus 30, so it's going to be plus 30 divided by 1,000, right? Okay, again, I'd like to get that answer too. Divide that, you need to divide that by 1,000.
Yeah, that
0.093
and then multiply it by
98. And what'd you get?
Negative 8.94.
Okay, negative 8.94?
Yeah.
My mistake, I thought you said 894. My mistake. I was gonna say, that's why I asked you, okay? That's my mistake, okay? So that's that one, okay? Next one, delta G of CO. Well, this is going to be 4 times whatever this is. Everybody see that? Why it's 4? You've got 4 moles of it. So then the same thing. Delta H is minus 110. And let's see, plus 298. Times 0.197.
Isn't that minus
2? Did I miss that?
Isn't that subtracting sign in the equation with the formula?
Yep, thank you.
So it's 197.9
divided by 3. I just moved it over three places. Do you see how if you're a little bit sloppy, and I like to say I'm doing this intentionally, but this is what happens when you do these long problems. If you miss one sign, everything goes crazy. What do we get for that? Remember, everything has to be multiplying 4 times whatever this addition and subtraction is. Anybody else get that answer?
Yeah.
Okay, good, because I have. Okay, so we have each one of these, right? Now we go over here, and again, this is the way I like to do it. Delta G is equal to delta G products minus delta G reactants. So let's look at each with the product. Right now, we got these two, so we need to add them. So we got this and this. So we would take minus 8.94 minus 675.90 minus this number, which is going to be minus 338.902. A little sloppy here.
apologize. And when we do that, we put this in our calculator, what do we get?
That's the parentheses, I mean, does the brackets represent parentheses?
Yes.
Okay.
I use the brackets because I find when I use I like brackets. Parentheses is just as good. That one of the answers?
Oh, 45.
Okay, and then they rounded it up to 346. So. What's bothering you? Just old stuff. Pardon?
I was just looking at it. I was trying to figure out what we're multiplying the temperature by, but then I looked at the equation. It's
a lot of stuff here. Okay. And if no one in the town meeting has the wrong answer, I feel good. Because everyone's has a rigor. But you see the stupid mistakes I made? Forgot a sign. Those, I can't stress enough, I'd like to say I did it intentionally, but I didn't. Those are what you're going to go through when you do this, because test anxiety is going to kick in, and you're going to miss a sign. And this is the easiest way of doing it. Some people like to do it all in one glob, and you never can find out what you did wrong. If you did this, you can maybe get an idea. Can I erase this thing? Everybody good? What I'm going to do now, so that I get an idea everybody can do it, is I'm going to just give you a problem, not do anything. I'll be back in 5 minutes and see if you get if everybody gets the right answer, okay? It's easy when you know the answer. Well, let's just see. Okay? Okay, number three. Okay? Again, what's different on number three? Look at the temperature. Right, so you're going to have to use that number. So I'll give everybody about 5 minutes. And if you get this one right, you know what my comment is? You're good for any problem she gives you on this stuff. Then we'll go to the next set of problems. Okay. And we'll see the answer, but more important, that for those of you who have a calculator, try to do it, because this way you can see if you mess up. Did anybody have a problem getting this answer?
I have a problem. It's just with that. It's that my question was that do I take the 54.8 and convert that into kilojoules right there by
you have to, because the answer is in kilojoules.
Okay.
So you got to convert it in kilojoules, and remember, the other trick of this thing is you got to, the temperature here is 750, so you got to multiply it by 750. Otherwise, it's just what we just did. So everybody pretty good on it then? Okay. Then what I'm going to do is not bore you with doing more of these problems. I think everybody's going to handle it. Let me talk about some of the other problems here, okay? Okay, if you look at this, it says spontaneous at low temperatures and non-spontaneous at high temperatures. So if we look at that chart, which quadrant is that going to be in? And we're going to call the one on the right first quadrant, one next one second, third and fourth, just like in trig. So what quadrant would you say this should be in? Everybody see that? What are the conditions in one? Okay, so they won't say, they'll say this also. You can either say negative or Okay, and if you look in the six, that's the answer, B. Okay, that's that easy. Okay, and you're gonna get at least one of these, maybe two of these. And again, what do you have to do? Just copy that onto your flashcard, and that's effectively how to read it. Okay, look at problem two, again from the study guide. Okay, a couple of rules of thumb. Let's talk about entropy. Remember, entropy is a state of disorder. I didn't do this specific one, but it's something like this.
Yeah.
Okay, entropy is a state of disorder. What does that mean? The more disordered something is, okay, just a couple rules here. First of all, the more something is random, the more entropy you're going to have. So let's talk about gases versus liquids versus solids. Does everybody see why a gas would have more entropy than a solid or the same gas? Why? Yeah, does everybody understand that? More free movement? And why would a liquid have more than a solid?
It has more movement than a solid because a solid is more compact.
A solid can't move, right? You know, if you take a liquid, it, again, my example is a bottle of Coke. Okay, they take the bottle, nothing moves, right? Okay, you take the liquid and pour it out, it goes everywhere, right? Okay, let's try. What happens if you just had nothing in the bottle and you had some gas, like carbon dioxide gas? You would open it up, the gas would go everywhere.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably, you're right, especially if it's a hot day. But that's what that means. And why is that important? Because to solve these chemical equation problems, you need to know that the entropy, and this is something of a change from a gas to a liquid to a solid or vice versa is much larger than the entropy of a change of a number of moles in a problem. Now, with the problems we have, okay, if we get theoretical, you can have a problem where you have 500 moles of material changing. But let's just look at these problems. There's problem A, B, C, D, and E. I'm going to write them all on the board here. And when you're doing these, it's very important to look at the states. This will be the last problem I'm going to go over today. Okay, let's talk about one more thing. The other thing I want to go with everybody is when you look at a chemical equation, what you want to do is to determine if, in this case, the question is which one of the following reactions is accompanied by an increase in entropy. In this case, we're looking for an increase in entropy. Before we get to that, let's talk a little bit about reactions. Okay, you notice these are all in the same state?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what would you, we go from four molecules on the left to two molecules on the right. What would you think would be with the entropy? Would it be increasing, decreasing, or stay the same? What'd you say? And the reason? That's correct. Does everybody see that? Okay, so let's make this a little more interesting. Right? Yep, I have it balanced right. Okay, so we can do this one a little bit so it's easy to see. Okay, in this case, we have two on this side. How many do we have on this side? So this will be an increase, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, let me do something to you. Drive you crazy. Nope, that won't do that. Let's see. Okay. What would you say for the entropy on this one? Say it again? Why? Right, and they're both the same, right?
Yes.
Okay, now let's do this. This is not correct, technically. What would you say now? Because the solid is more important than the number of molecules. Okay, and the reason is the entropy energy to change from a liquid to a solid, or vice versa, again, like I mentioned, it far outweighs the change in number of moles. So with that in mind, let's look at each one of these problems. I'm going to go around the table and ask everybody why. Okay? We know the answer is D, but we're going to talk about everything but D. Okay?
The answer is B.
Is it? Then we know the answer is B. Thank you.
Okay, so let me go around. Ready? You ready? Your shot? Why is A not the right answer?
Well, for one, the reactants have more molecules, and also the state of matter. It's a liquid to a gas, to a solid gas.
Think about it. 17 plus 1 is 18, right?
Yeah, and over there is 20.
Right, so you're going from, so if you just went with pure reactant, from reactants to products, that would be an increase, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we want to know if there's an increase in entropy.
There would be an increase. So then it's just the state of matter?
That's the guiding. I always go with the most random state. In this case, it's the gas, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, it goes from 17. So that is not an increase, it's a decrease. Okay? This is, you know, where, you know, it outweighs it, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody see that? Again, you've got, when you look at these, focus on the most entropic of the in the formula. So the gases would be the first one in the liquids, okay? Okay? We're going to skip B. We're going to go to, I'll take a shot at C.
Yeah, it goes from 5 to 4, so it's an increase in the gas state.
Okay, these are all gases, right?
Well, yeah. Well,
because, what I named the state here is 2. I can't add it. So it goes from 7 to 6, so it's a decrease, right?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody see that? Okay, you're not getting out of here without input. You're not going to go to that place and get more donuts.
I have to go to work.
Yeah. Right. That's today's excuse. Okay. All right. Do D for me. You or me.
Me?
Yeah.
This is incorrect because it's going from a solid to a gas and then back to a solid, which is a decrease at the very end. So it started off decreasing and then a decrease at the end.
Yep. Does everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for your for the last minute.
Yeah.
Want to try E?
Well, yeah, decreases. Well, no, it goes from 5 to 6.
Yeah, but remember, we gotta go. We use the state first. What's a?
Liquid,
I don't think.
Gas, and then gas liquid.
Yeah, but think about this way again. Goes from 4 to 3.
Only the
circle. Yeah. Everybody see that?
Yes.
Okay. Her observation was okay, so ready? Want to take a shot? Thank you.
Which one?
Boy, the one left.
give me
a good reason.
You're going from solid and then gas, so it's increasing.
That's one reason. Is there a second reason why you would do it if they were? In this case, if they're both the same state, they would be 1 and 2. Okay, so in that case, exactly right. That's why it's an increase. Okay? That's it. Hopefully this will be live. And I will have a review session Monday morning. Did you say what time the test is starting? Monday? 9 o'clock, right? So I'll be here early. So if there's any last questions, and what I'll be doing on Monday will be what I've done in the past, is just go over flashcards, stuff to put in your flashcards. Okay, thank you very much.